Hi, I'm Vincenzo Coya, and welcome to Stat 545, the video series designed to help you write a clean and modern data analysis. If I asked you what the most effective way is to communicate your data, I bet graphs come to mind. Here's a scatter plot telling us that bigger penguins tend to have bigger flippers. Color each point by penguin species, and we can also tell that Gentoo penguins are almost always bigger than the similarly sized Adélie and Chinstrap penguins. Pretty clear, right? Now compare that to a table of the same data. And that same message is not as obvious. So then why do we see so many tables and presentations and articles? Probably because graphing is notorious for being difficult. Not only do we have to design the graph, but then we have to find a way to make it too. But making graphs doesn't have to be a hassle. In R, there's a package called ggplot2 that can help you make just about any data-oriented graphic. ggplot2 is based on something called the grammar of graphics, hence the GG, and this is basically a way of encoding a graph. Here's the idea. Give me the 7 components and I can tell you what the graph is. Or give me a graph and I can tell you what the 7 components are. In today's episode, we'll warm up to plot making with ggplot2 by identifying the 3 most important grammar of graphics components and how to use them. Data, aesthetic mappings, and geometric objects. To help build concepts, we'll stick with scatter plots for today, but we'll branch out in future episodes. So to load ggplot2, go ahead and load the tidyverse, and when you do, we have 4 practices to help you get started. First, specify your data in the ggplot function. The first component of the grammar of graphics is your data, and your data should be in the form of a tibble or a data frame. Specify your data by simply putting it as the first argument of the ggplot function. You could run this function as is, but you wouldn't get very much, just a blank canvas. It's often useful to wrangle your data before plotting it. If this is the case, it's convenient to just pipe this wrangled data into the ggplot function. Aside from the ggplot function, you can also make a plot using the qplot function. It stands for quickplot and has limited functionality, but it helps you make a plot with minimal code. You should probably only use quickplot if you want to take a quick glance at your data, not if you want to produce a lasting plot. So we won't be delving into it. Second, specify aesthetic mappings with the AES function. Now that you've specified your data, we need to tell ggplot2 what variable or column goes on the x-axis and what goes on the y-axis. To do this, specify the column names in the AES function, which itself goes into the second argument of the ggplot function. But you still won't get a scatter plot if you run this command, because ggplot2 still doesn't know that you want to draw points. To make things easier for us, I'm going to jump ahead a little bit and add points to the plot, but don't worry about the code for this yet. In general, the x and y axes are called aesthetics, which are ways in which we can perceive differences in a variable. The x and y aesthetics are mandatory in a scatter plot because we need to know where to put the points on the plot, but there are other aesthetics too, like size, color, and shape of the points. We probably wouldn't want to map the species variable onto the size aesthetic, because size is more suitable for variables that need a sliding scale. In other words, continuous variables like bill length. Let's use color instead, which, by the way, can use either the British or American spelling. Each aesthetic can accommodate a new variable from your data, but don't go overboard. There is such a thing as information overload. So just what is the second grammar of graphics? It's an aesthetic mapping. In other words, a specification of which variable goes with which aesthetic. Third is to specify a geometric object as a new layer. So the third grammar of graphics is a geometric object. And what that is it's basically the object that you'll use to depict your data. For a scatter plot, the geometric objects are just points, but we'll see in future episodes other examples like lines, bars, and box plots. The geometric object doesn't go into the ggplot function. In fact, we're done with the ggplot function. Instead, we need to add the geometric object as a new layer using the plus sign. Within the geom layer, you're able to specify more properties for that geometric object. In fact, you can outright specify values for aesthetics. For example, I can change the size of the points or the shape of the points. Probably my favorite property is alpha transparency. This makes your geometric object translucent so that your data doesn't obscure itself. You can specify the amount of transparency as a number between 0 and 1, where smaller numbers are more transparent. For number 4, we have a pro tip for you: make new variables on the fly. When you're specifying an aesthetic mapping, you don't always have to refer to columns that are present in your data. Instead, you can make new ones from existing columns. Let's start with an easy example and convert flipper length to centimeters. To do this, all we need to do is divide flipper length by 10. Here, it's as if a new column has been created in your data that is the old flipper length divided by 10. For another example, what if we wanted to use color to highlight the largest penguin? Instead of coloring by species, I'll color by whether or not the body mass equals the largest body mass. Notice what's going on here. This logical statement is making a new column of trues and falses, and is mapping this binary variable to the color aesthetic. This is also a source of mistakes. If we want to color our points green, setting color to green in the aesthetic function is really just making a new column in your data whose entries are all the word green. So I hope you feel ready to start plotting with ggplot2. When you do, keep 4 steps in mind. 1. Specify your data in the ggplot function. 2. Specify your aesthetic mappings in the AES function. 3. Specify your geometric objects as a new layer. And 4. Make new variables on the fly. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Join us next class where we continue our discussion on dplyr for data wrangling. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel so that you can stay up to date with more data analysis goodies.